Hello.
Hi, Michael. It's Bill Birnes. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you doing, Bill?
Good. I'm here with my co-host, Nancy. We're both here for tonight's show.
Hi, Michael.
Hi, Nancy.
Talk to you.
Hello.
Hi. How are you doing?
Good. How are
okay.
you?
I'm doing fantastic.
Okay, so I did write to Terrell, but I understand that he is kind of burned. We're not back on the air yet. Are we live?
Yeah, we're still live. We never
okay,
went
good.
On.
Okay, we're fine then. So I understand that. Why don't you tell? Well, first of all, let me introduce you properly. Michael Lee Hill, Lake Erie UFOs. Find Michael Hill on Facebook. Find Michael Hill on his website.
If you're lucky enough to be in chat, it's all linked up, and it will be on our site too.
And Michael and Terrell Copeland, who had a very unique similarity between them, even though they are very different people, were both on season one of UFO Hunters, and that was the critical episode of Alien Contact, where we were talking about more than just seeing strange lights in the sky, more than just seeing rigid-shaped craft. It was a sense that both Michael Lee Hill and Terrell Copeland felt that they had some kind of a relationship, undefined, but some kind of a relationship with whatever was guiding that light in the sky. And part of the episode was to try to explore that relationship and if there was any revelation coming out of that exploration. Really a path for Michael and a path for Terrell to seek whatever it is, the answers that they learned from that own explanation. So that really is Terrell Copeland, Michael Lee Hill, Michael Lee Hill, Terrell Copeland in that first season of UFO Hunters. Folks can see it. We write about it, by the way. I wrote about it in the book that's coming out this September called UFO Hunters Book One. So folks can read it, and Michael's picture is in it, and Terrell's picture is in it, and folks can read it when the book comes out.
Well, Michael, your long hair comes to you for an honest reason, correct? You're a musician?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, tell folks about your current situation.
Musically, things are going great. My last CD, which I did the soundtrack, I became a co-producer with David Sarita for a UFO documentary called From Here to Andromeda. And the soundtrack I released as a CD, and it was just added into Pandora Radio, which I'm really excited about.
Congratulations.
Ah, thank you. Another gentleman that I came in contact with, his name's Dan Reed, and he is an Arcturian contactee, as it turns out. This guy was a huge influence on me. He was hand-selected by Mick Jagger to open up for the Rolling Stones for 60 shows on the Steel Wheels tour. He toured with David Bowie, toured with Bon Jovi.
Wait. You said he was
an Arcturian?
Arcturian contactee. Yeah, I met him face-to-face. He and I have become great friends, and I'm playing with him at his Cleveland upcoming concert, May 25th. So I'm really excited. Music has been my love, and I'm really starting to understand how entwined it is with the subject
in
that we're
way?
Speaking about.
In how?
Frequency creates geometry. You know, you get into this subject of sacred geometry, and it's just proven now. Like, you can take a metal plate that has some type of polymer on it, like a sand, and then they have a bow that's tuned to, like, an A note. When you sound that plate, you'll see geometry form. They can do the same thing with putting frequency through, like, water molecules, and even Dr. Emoto's work so you start to understand that the universe is being sung into existence. You know, everything's vibrating, everything's frequency, and we're starting to understand that thoughts have an electromagnetic reality to them. We're sending out waveforms that is sound. It's just not audible. And, when
also,
you start to...
Also,
sorry,
they just now, just about a week ago, I was reading that the amount of vibrations coming from the heart muscle, that you have a heart aura or a heart vibration area of 8 feet around your body.
Yeah.
And,
more powerful than anything.
And music and your heart, it's almost like music speaks to your heart first and then your head.
Isn't that something?
Yeah, it does. It seems to, you know.
It would be incredible.
That's something I'm really fascinated with right now, is sacred geometry and how it relates to all of this. I think it's a very fascinating subject.
Well, have you ever heard about or heard of the man Jose Arguelles?
Arguelles.
That does ring a bell, but I'm not. It's not coming up to my conscious mind here.
He's the man. He's no longer alive, but he was behind the harmonic convergence, and he's the fellow who has kind of, if you wanted to look into this, he puts us on sidereal time basically instead of solar time, and it supposedly makes all the difference in everything. Nature doesn't follow sun time; it follows star time basically.
Ah, very interesting.
So I'm off the top of my head. I don't have the websites, but if you just typed in J-O-S-E in the search form and then A-R-G-U-I-L-L-E-S and then the word time, you know, he would come up. And it's all about vibrations. In other words, he fought really hard to try to make, to allow a newosphere to form around the Earth, and that we're responsible for changing the vibration of the actual thing around the Earth, so that aliens would then know that that our planet was ready for a higher level of communication.
That's very interesting. That fits really in with some of the things we can talk about tonight.
We'll have the correct link up for folks. It's now up in chat, and if you're in front of a computer, you can just hit our chat, and it's right there.
Ah, fantastic! I definitely will check it out, because that's where my curiosity is leading me right now, is into that bed of knowledge. I think that there's a lot to be discovered and remembered.
Well, why don't you tell everybody how you started along the path, when you first started to see lights over Lake Erie?
That would have been about 2005. At this time, I didn't know what they were. I thought maybe it was a natural phenomenon. As a matter of fact, I just knew they were beautiful. I didn't know what was happening. It wasn't until you and the UFO Hunters crew came here. If you remember, one of the producers brought over a laptop and said, I would like you to give your comment on this video. This was shot in England. And when he showed it to me, I was like, oh, my God, this is the exact same thing that's over Lake Erie. It wasn't even a question in my mind. Mm-hmm. And the guy laughed, and he goes, yeah, that's why we're asking you. You know. So that was the first premonition I ever had that this was happening anywhere else. By the way, because of that, I started through networks of people that I started coming into contact with, I started to compile all of these news clips of these orbs of light that are showing up over all these major cities. I got so much to share with you on this, too. It's mind-blowing. But I put together this compilation of all these news clips, and it's hit 1.3 million views now on YouTube. It's called The Anunnaki Are Showing Up Worldwide is what I called it, and we can get into that.
Oh, wow, that sounds cool.
Why I named it that. But, yeah, check it out. It's online right now. And so about 2005, I started noticing these orbs of light, and I just started going down to the lake. I live very close, as Bill can tell you. We went down there as well. Remember that blizzard, Bill? It was so cold.
It was so cold, I thought I would die.
Really?
Yeah, I was laughing. Like, because when they first said, hey, let's go down there, I'm like, I don't think you understand, you know,
yeah,
how really cold
they don't call
it really
this
is.
A windy lake for nothing.
Wow. So it's way colder than surrounding areas, is what you're saying?
Well, you got the lake effect, and it's just, when there's a blizzard, Bill can tell you. I mean, it just, matter of fact, the next day when we did the filming, my face was totally windburned, you know.
That's ridiculous
on the show, but now you know why. But
did the orbs kind of draw you down to that terrible climate?
No, that was the History Channel. I don't go down when it's that cold. I'll wait till it's nice. But they wanted to, you know, the producers and whatnot wanted to take a look at it and thought it makes for some cool footage, you know, to go down there during this. And so we went down. I go down, and any nice chance I have, that if it's a nice day, you'll find me down there. It's my home away from home. But I started to accumulate quite a library of footage, and this one clip in particular, which was in 2007, showed you know, there's this huge double-orbed object out over the lake, and then another object comes and hovers right over top of it. And that had went viral, and it's about 1.2 million views right now on YouTube, and that's what kind of brought the History Channel to my door. And so at this point, you know, going to Boston and having the blood work done by the Harvard doctor, David Systrom, was just mind-blowing. And that's really where this all began, and I'm really excited to get to talk to you both, because everything has, that was like just the tip of the iceberg of what's happening.
That was the beginning. That was the whole point. I mean, here, both you and Terrell both had these experiences in which you kind of had a premonition something would happen. It was something, it just was outside the realm of coincidence that you happened to show up when a strange orb was overhead, or Terrell happened
but
to look out his
so
window.
But this sounds so much
like
Lynn Kitai's experiences with the Phoenix Lights.
It does. That's
exactly.
That's so strange about this. But there was also the sense that there was a connection. And then as Terrell began going into, and you began going into your thoughts about what was communicating with you, that was when we did the blood test. And it was really only because Terrell had said something was wrong with his blood. He didn't know what it was, but that was why the Marines told him he had to leave because of a medical problem. And since you and Terrell were having the same experiences, you both went to Mass General, and that was when this amazing thing popped up in your blood work.
Which
yes,
is?
Yes, indeed. What it was an increase of creatine kinase into the bloodstream. And, Bill, I can tell you as well, I've got so much information now on what this actually is.
Well, go ahead.
And
tell
it came through – by the way, I'm going to back up, because during this show, it was controversial, this episode, because you had flat out said, I believe you're hybrids, and I believe that you're being prepared by a group of insiders, you know, or you will be prepared by a group of insiders.
I still believe it, Michael.
To help you process this, and that happened in real life, and I've got a lot of information. And a matter of fact, the head of this group, his name is A.R. Borden, and he and I did interview yesterday, which was his first interview ever to the mass public. And what I found out is creatine kinase, in normal human blood, it's about 25 parts per liter of blood. And if there's been muscle damage, it'll go up to about 250 to 300 tops. And the reason that it increases creatine kinase in the blood to facilitate healing is that it brings oxygen into the bloodstream. And what I found out is oxygen in the bloodstream equates to how much electrical capacitance is available on a cellular level.
Mm-hmm.
And so
oxygen
much,
is the conductor?
Yeah. And what's interesting is, so the normal amounts are about 25 parts per liter of blood. It'll go up to about 250, 300 if you've been damaged. Well, Terrell's and my levels were over 2,100. And I heard the producer, by the way, when because you guys are really good at, like, I didn't know anything that was going on. And really, the reactions in the show are real, because I didn't know. But I did overhear her tell another producer that she goes, oh, my God, his levels are almost identical to Terrell's.
Right. That was one of the aspects of this thing.
Well,
like,
wait a second. One question. Is this stuff released during extreme stress, like fight or flight type thing, like extreme extreme?
24/7, and that's what the Dr. David Systrom said. It's really weird. In like Terrell's case, it was the same levels over years of, you know, being tested. That there was no medical reason why he should have these kind of levels.
And what
I heard is, what happens is that extra electrical capacitance at a cellular level can be thought of as chi or life energy. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some people may have it and never even do anything with it.
It
might just lie dormant. you know.
But it could, but it, Michael, it could also prepare you for psychic connection. It opens up more brain cells or something, and so that's why I was wondering if it's at a near death moment, for example, under extreme stress, that maybe opens us up to what the rest of the world is, and we normally are cloaked, and you know,
indeed,
like suddenly
Nancy.
The DMT takes over. It doesn't. It's not suppressed anymore. But in your case, it would be a real physical reason why communication can open up, because suddenly there's increased oxygen in the blood. Lots
that
of
that is exactly what A.R. Borden said. And more even interesting than that is not a lot of people know this because it wasn't stated on the UFO Hunters show, but David Sistrom told us off camera that the only thing he could think of would be some kind of virus, and like an unknown virus. Mm-hmm. That he said not all viruses are bad, but they can work on the level of DNA, and the only thing that he could think of would be that there's some kind of unknown virus that's tricking the brain into releasing these massive amounts of creatine kinase. Mm-hmm. But what I'm finding out is it is truly a bloodline, and I was told that the information of what we're talking about is going to enter the scientific journals within the next 5 years.
Wow.
Which I find very, very fascinating.
Yeah. Well, did you ask your mother whether she ever had a blood test and whether creatine kinase turned up in her blood test?
Yes, she doesn't, but my biological father.
Want to drop the bomb?
If you would like to.
Go ahead.
You found out right along with me, so.
I did. Well, you told me. It
and I know, mind. And I didn't tell.
And nobody told, so it's up to you to drop the bomb.
It's Eric Clapton. I'm going to be 45 tomorrow, and
Well, isn't that weird? Now, here's the thing. I got to insert this before the show, to relax and to kind of get in the mood. I play tunes from my iTunes, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I hit the random button, and I played Eric Clapton just before the show, and I have one Eric Clapton in my whole entire collection. Period.
Wow.
Yeah.
They say there's no coincidences, huh?
Well, did Eric Clapton have elevated creatine kinase?
He had. He told my biological mother that he called himself a blue blood, and a lot of things that he had communicated to her were very accurate. As far as like, he told her that we're not being told the truth about really what's happening, and he wasn't truly from here, is what he told her.
Wow.
Well, when you say blue blood, you mean literally, then maybe that's what it means. I mean, okay, talk about two things. Talk about this is a bloodline, and then you have to go back and talk about this fellow that interviewed you last night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay,
yes,
but
indeed.
Talk about the bloodline, Michael.
Yeah. Well, let me tell you what happened with all this, because, so we're talking the beginning of 2008 is when, I was with you, Bill, and the History Channel crew. The middle of 2008, after that episode aired, I was dating this girl at the time that owned a metaphysical jewelry store, and she was going to this festival in New York. Brushwood is what it's called. So I went, and I just really thought I was going camping, and I didn't really realize what it is, and make a long story short, I was met by people at this time. This is the summer of 2008, and how this happened was this one gentleman kind of took me under his wing there, and his name was Loki. And at one point, he said he was going to go back to the campground and kind of check to see if everything was still buttoned down. And I said, well, I'm not doing nothing. I'll go with you. And when we got there, there was a structure that was on the premises. And everyone called it the genie bottle, because once you got in it, it really kind of looked like you were inside that I Dream of Genie bottle, from the 60s show.
Yeah.
When we got back there, he said, someone's waiting inside the genie bottle to talk to you. And when I went in, there was a male and a female that were on this structure. And just to get right to the brunt of this, they had multiple people there. They had announced to me that they were of a race that has been known as the Anunnaki. And at this time, there was no ancient aliens on TV. I had never read a Zachariah Sitchin book. I didn't know what an Anunnaki even was,
Right.
And so this started, it was actually kind of antagonistic at first. He said, this guy asked me, he goes, we want to know if you know anything about this young man that was just on Coast to Coast talking about a certain Boyd Bushman from Lockheed Martin. I said,
right.
Yeah, I know everything about that. That's David Sarita, and he's talking about, you know, Boyd Bushman, who was in our From Here to Andromeda film, and he just, Boyd just spilled the beans, man. He was a senior scientist for Lockheed Martin. He showed us working anti-gravity. He showed us blueprints for the first craft that flew in 1959 that was built by Conair. And so this guy in front of me goes on to tell me that he is part of the J. Allen Hynek family, and that family is still in charge of what gets released to the masses. And he went on to tell me that J. Allen Hynek actually hated the position our government put him in because they would make him say one thing one day and then contradict himself
true.
The next.
Well, yeah, and what I think one of his prized possessions, and this would give you an idea of the man, when he after he died, was a portrait painted of him sort of in full garb of Illuminati robe type things, you know, Mason robes or whatever, because he really felt that he had to hide that whole side of himself and tell the world another whole thing. So that's
an, interesting. That's
and
exactly
with a special, he had a very special ring, and it's in the portrait. And I don't know who owns that portrait now.
That's really interesting. I didn't know that. I guess it fits in perfectly with what they're telling me. He said that this group of people still determine what gets revealed to the masses, and Boyd Bushman was not on the list. And he asked me, he said, how did this come to be? We're the ones who decide what gets released. You've caused a lot of problems for people behind the scenes and a lot of finger-pointing, is what he said. And I said, well, that was my baby. That, you know, as Bill can tell you, that From Here to Andromeda was my, I willed that into manifestation pretty much, you know, and I worked really hard to get it done, and I'm really proud of it.
What part did David Sarita play?
What had happened was earlier on in all this, I had my first interview with CBS News here, and 1 week before they went to show my footage, I was drugged, and when I woke up, my jaw had been shattered. I was broke my jaw in two places on the left side and one place on the right side, and I had to have the whole left side of my face wired back together.
And are you a singer?
Yes, I am. You know, that was interesting. I will say that I was really bummed out that this was going to stop me from singing. And I thought, you know, Tibetan monks chant and they heal themselves through singing and chanting. And I thought, I'm going to try to sing with my face wired up. And at first I was really frightened and I was really gentle and just, you know, but what I found is it didn't hurt at all. I sang all the way through my rehabilitation.
I have just come off of a huge writing thing that it's best we don't go into right now because it's a bitter story with a happy ending.
But
have you ever heard of the music that Robbie Robertson makes?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. From the band?
The Lakota Healing Song, which is so sexy a song. It's one of the richest sounding, kindest songs I've ever heard in my life. I used to play it every time before it, to get into the mood. And other
so
American, I like American Indians, Native American Indians, and if at all possible, have you ever heard of Nakota Heavy Runner, for example?
No, I haven't.
Okay, he's a real guy who's simply, you know how they have those circles and those drumming circles?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That men, well, he's one of those, and he's kind of made a name for himself, and he's made up his songs. He does a few traditional songs, but he makes up his new songs. They're sort of modern songs, but they're still like those circle songs, the pounding men circle songs. Very interesting stuff, anyway.
Very interesting. I hear that has a lot to do with what we're talking about with bloodlines, because indigenous American Indians, I heard that what happens is, you know, there is such a thing as cellular memory, and that when you have a culture that has, you know, keys to multidimensional travel still fresh and, like, our origins not from here, but that we're actually all from the cosmos. When those kind of ideas are kept within a culture, they're very at the surface of that culture's cellular memory. And the two cultures that have kept this alive the most is American Indian, which, by the way, Bill, with the adoption thing, for the first time in my life, I found out that I am fourth generation Seneca Indian.
Wow.
Out of New York as well.
Wow.
But it kind of makes sense because they said that the American Indians and the kind of secret society European people, which is kind of almost like they probably have twisted it in another direction, but those are the two that have this memory at a surface level that, you know, you can get to through meditation and whatnot.
Well, I'll tell you this much. Having spent time with the Jicarilla Apache when we did the Delcy episode, and then again when I did the Delcy episode for Ancient Aliens, having spent time with the Jicarilla Apache, there is a sense they have their own definitions of a true blood, which is all four grandparents are Native American, that there is no Caucasian mixed in. And those that aren't. So even though legally, if you are one quarter or one half indigenous American, you can live on the reservation. But in the hierarchical culture of leadership, those whose four grandparents have four grandparents who are Native American, they have a certain kind of a status within the group. And so that means, and this is what interested me when I heard about it, that you, Michael, are right about the idea of a bloodline that really stays narrow and confined. And so assuming just for the sake of
is this a hybrid line?
No. I'm saying it's an original line.
No, I mean hybrids, original line of hybrids.
I don't think so.
Of aliens.
I don't think so. I think
like blends that finally worked.
I don't think they're blends. I think they are aliens.
Yeah, but wouldn't – okay.
So
are you saying some – because I kind of get the feeling that if you can unravel DNA, you'll find out we all come from the stars.
Well, we do.
And
that's
so
what I think.
Michael would be just from a different
–
interesting subject because you know, what happened was, from my understanding, everyone is has cosmic origin, but yet once mankind was genetically tweaked and the Homo sapien was created and brought into the Eden, in the Sumerian telling of it, that further genetic tinkering happened to create the royal Nephilim bloodline, which is the Anunnaki human hybrid bloodline, which is separate from mankind bloodline.
Well, let's say, Michael, that let's just take a snapshot of the Garden of Eden. A snapshot. There are three
There were no cell phones.
There were no cell phones. Well, we'll do a snapshot. There were three otherworldly...
Wouldn't it be cool if cell phones become really cell phones, like we phone from ourselves?
Well, I think that's what's going to happen anyway.
I think that's where the conversation is going.
No. No, it's not. I'm saying if you had a snapshot of, you know, the first few years in the Garden of Eden and afterwards, you are talking about three separate otherworldly species or species, right? I mean,
right.
There is a reptilian, the serpent. There is the Nephilim, those who fell from the stars, and there's the Homo sapien, and they all interact.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. You know, because I really don't think that, you know, the Anunnaki, or from what I understand, because getting back to A.R. Borden, he is of a group of insiders that are of the highest echelon of the NSA, actually. And we're going to find out that... you know, the Muroc Field meeting in 1954, it's coming out now. Like Bob Dean has released this information as well, that the Anunnaki met with our government and asked us, you know, for a peaceful first contact. But they warned us, first of all, about nuclear energy programs and that we had to abandon these and they'd help us get into free energy. And some of the things as far as secret societies of oil and banking families that were looking out for their own pockets instead of the welfare of mankind, those systems have to go, you know, because they're not, if we're going to go into becoming a galactic society, all these systems of our society that isn't just, you know, obviously they have to be replaced with systems that that work.
So what you're saying sounds like a message I heard from a different angle this week when I was listening to one of the more recent Psychedelic Salon things. Psychedelic Salon, Lorenzo was the host, and he gathers up interesting radio shows for people. Just go there, and it's just... And so he had a woman on named Annie Oak, I believe her name is, and she's sort of a speaker now for women in this esoteric stuff. And she's saying the reason that women don't speak up and aren't on panels and, you know, you won't see them as part of symposia is because women have been, you know, it's not a safe thing to do. You can lose your family. You can be, you know.
Right.
But, I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought with this one. Okay, so people are, but what I'm noticing is people are coming at this very same thought from different angles. And yeah. Her feeling is that the plants, the entheogens, will open you up, and that the powers that be, the military paradigm that keeps everything in the status quo right now, so that we would consume like cows, you know, or cattle, would just be, and consume cows, for God's sake.
Right.
So forth and so on. So that yes. whole paradigm, that's all part of, that's why your consciousness is the last civil right. It's being legislated. Your consciousness is being changed, but it's being changed legitimately through caffeine and sugar. And as you saw from that junk food guy a couple of nights ago on TV,
right?
That stuff is really as much a drug as anything else. Sugar, caffeine, and so as Terrence McKenna says, it puts you in the alert problem solving state. And in that state, we haven't really solved our problems. That's the thing. We solve the problems for the corporations. So what you're saying, that somebody is telling you, you know, to bring this message out, is almost like making me think that what we're all calling UFOs or demons or psychedelics or this or that, it's some other, it's an intelligence right here with us, sharing the planet with us, trying to get through to us because we are destructive.
Yeah, they've been here all along from what I'm understanding. With my own research into this phenomenon in the Lake Erie area, which I've learned so much, I'm really glad to be able to share this with you guys, that I trace back into the 1800s from newspapers of this area from that time, two different newspaper articles of these people would witness these balls of fire out over the lake, and they called them wizard lights back then. And, you know, for a while, I guess people would go out and try to see if there was a ship that was on fire out there, and somehow it was like a mirage that made it look like it was above the horizon, and there would be nothing there, you know. So at least in this area, it goes back into the 1800s, and it's verifiable. But what's really interesting with this is there's a guy, his name is Zimmerman. I think Zach Zimmerman, if I'm not, you know what, I'm not, I might be off on the name. I know the last name is Zimmerman, but he just wrote a book with a companion book to it as well, and it's called The Fallen Angels of Ohio Valley. The Nephilim Chronicles is what it's called. And he traced the migration of a race of beings that have giant skeletal structures. They migrated from all over the world to this area.
That's fascinating.
Yes, isn't it? And
well,
what's really fascinating is they all came here and they started making these earth mounds all along Lake Erie.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, is the serpent mound in that area?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, and what you see is he wrote a companion book to the first book, and these were just released, by the way, so this is brand new information. And what it is a tour guide of all these different places, where they're located at, and pictures of the giant skeletons that have been removed from these earth mounds.
Well, now, where are the
giant
skeletons?
We'll check that out. Yeah.
Where are the giant skeletons? Do you know where the giant skeletons are now, Michael?
That's a good question. I want to get the book myself, you know, so I can see. I'm sure they're in museums or something. But
yeah, because that's a real easy Photoshop job, and in fact, it's been proven time and time again to be Photoshopped, those photographs. But the real skeleton would be something else, you know.
Be mind-blowing.
But just the serpent mound itself, it's the sort of thing, if you start looking at pictures of it online, you begin to say, wait a second, this is head-scratchingly weird, you know, dropped down
it's
here.
It's kind of like Nazca lines, where you really can't even tell what it is until you see it from above.
Yeah,
right.
You know, I think that's really interesting. But let me tell you the most interesting thing is, during a conversation with this A.R. Borden, he asked me, he goes, Michael, you know what's underneath you in that area, don't you? And I said, I've heard maybe, because, you know, I had some people from Black Ops kind of infiltrated my life. And this one woman had told me that I'm sitting on one of the world's biggest underground bases in this area. So I responded back. I heard that maybe there's an underground base or something, but I'm not really sure. And he said, absolutely. It's one of the oldest underground bases in the world. He said, one of the entrances, he said the last time he was down there was in 2007. He said he took that long drive down Route 75. And I got onto the internet, and I Googled Ohio, Route 75. It goes right into Wright-Patterson Air Force Base.
That's so true. That's true. Because you're in northern Ohio, so you're heading south towards Vandalia, and that's where Wright Field is.
Or are these bases for people or for something else?
It's not our bases. It's Anunnaki. They've been here all along.
So finish up the genie bottle story. How'd you get out of the bottle?
Well, at this point, when he asked me what I knew about it, and I said, well, that's my film, you know, and he said, well, and then he went into that this Boyd Bushman information being released to the public was not a part of their plan, and they're the ones that are in charge of it. And he said, we need to know what you know. And at this point, he brought out a wand that looked like it had a purple diode at the end of it. Mm-hmm. And I could feel it. It was stimulating my third eye, the pineal gland, you know. I could feel it. It felt really good, actually, because you probably started bringing out DMT. And at this point, from what I understand happened, is there's way better ways of lie detectors or getting to know what you know, and it is accessing your Akashic records through the pineal gland. There's technology from extraterrestrials that they can see every incarnation you've ever lived, and you know.
Oh well. Wait now. How much liquor do you consume, and or any other kind of drugs of a day ever?
I drink beer a little bit. I do enjoy. I can't say that over.
Sure, you
things
can.
Things that are of nature. We'll leave it at that. I wasn't. This isn't. I've had so many experiences after this, and not only that, I spent 2 days with them. You know, the first meeting in the genie bottle. This is say Saturday night. Right when I seen them, I couldn't see their faces, which is interesting because the person that was sitting before me was known as Ra in Egypt, and he was Marduk, and the Sumerian colonies. I'm finding out that these beings have been around for a while, and they've been known under many different names. But he's known as the Hidden One. Ra is, you know, and when I seen them, I didn't know this at the time, but picture you're sitting there in front of someone, and they look totally normal, and you can see everything up to their necks, but when you get to their face, they're faceless.
Well, was it in shadow, or was there light? You know, in other words,
when
you say
you know
faceless?
It was all candlelit in the genie bottle, but it was almost like there was a dark shadow that was arising from nothing that kind of just tracked their face. And I said, can I see your real faces? And he said, no, you'll have to wait till tomorrow to see our true faces. And sure enough, I ended up, you know, this is in the daytime now, and they made me lunch, and I sat there and spent hours with him. And right, what happened is the next morning when I arose and got up out of my tent and I grabbed a bottle of water and just poured it over my head as like a morning wake-up, you know. And right when I looked up, this gentleman and his female companion was walking by the tent on the dirt road that went by it. And instantly I knew it was the couple from the previous night. It was really interesting what he said to me. It was kind of interesting. He said, "Good morning, Commander Michael." I said, "Well, good morning. I have no idea what a commander is in the Sumerian telling of it, but so getting back to that, once they did this probe and I could feel it stimulate my pineal gland, he became really excited and pretty much said, "Oh my God, you're one of us." You know, we didn't know. We've been waiting for you to appear so we could have a council meeting. And now that you're here, if you don't mind, we could have it right now. I said, "I have no idea what you're talking about."
Well,
but
in all your studies before or since then, have you ever heard of the nine?
I have afterwards, because Sammy Hagar named his publishing company the nine. And
okay.
He said he's come out publicly now that he's been contacted by the Council of Nine,
right.
And they've imparted knowledge and pretty much downloaded and uploaded information into his brain. And what's really interesting is if you look at Sammy Hagar's new band is called Chickenfoot, and their logo is the Dinjir, which is the Anunnaki symbol in Sumeria, or Sumer,
wow.
Which... I think it's very fascinating. But the nine are Anunnaki. That's who we're speaking of. And
okay,
there's a council that are called the Cortium that work with the NSA in very deep levels that I'm finding out, which is how A.R. Borden comes into
play. Here's what I mean by the nine. Not who the nine were trying to communicate with, and that was the nine, the celestial nine of, you know, Egypt and stuff. I think the nine you're talking about. But the nine that I'm talking about are the nine very high-placed Americans who really in the 30s maybe? I'm not quite sure. Went up to a shed in Maine. They're all wealthy, wealthy people. I see that, you know, our chat is kind of keeping up and adding information to this chicken foot, and that's the logo. But if you just, it's in Peter Levenda talks about it a bit, but this is a very hooded group, and they felt they had to be together in order to contact this other group. And one of the people in the human nine is one of the people who started.
It's Buharic, right?
Yes, Buharic.
Right, and Buharic was the one who brought.
So let's talk about the fellow who interviewed you.
Yeah,
who is he,
yeah.
and maybe we can connect those dots.
Actually, he didn't interview me. A.R. Borden is the head of a now dismantled group called the Life Physics Group out of California, and that's kind of an interesting reason why it got disbanded too. But as Bill predicted accurately, he said, I think that you're going to be offered a course of study by, you know, a group that can help you put a framework around what you're experiencing, and that's exactly what happened. And the first thing they did, they said, "You need a crash course in what's going on," and they supplied me with the full library of Zachariah Sitchin's work. And they said, "Zachariah Sitchin and his son are more correct than they even knew," in their own words. And so that's when I started learning about the Anunnaki, and they started informing me about the bloodline. And at the time, like I said, I didn't know what the Anunnaki were, and I didn't know that it's not just one bloodline, I guess you could call it, within the Anunnaki themselves, that there's different factions within the Anunnaki who perhaps have different agendas as well, you know? And starting to understand that, they've helped me out with that quite a bit. I had no clue what was even happening.
Where does David Sirita fit into all this?
He was your filmmaker.
I just want to know, how does he appear on the picture?
After I was attacked and I had my jaw wired shut, that night for the CBS interview, I was sitting here watching it. They came to the house, and it was kind of weird because they had some equipment problems when they were at my house, but we got through it. That night, first of all, I almost canceled the interview because my face, I'd gotten back from the hospital with my face wired together, and it's about 4 days now before the interview, and I really couldn't talk much, you know? And something just came over me because I was about to cancel the interview, and something... I said, I'll mumble through it, you know, and that's what happened. But that night, when they went to air it, something took out their whole TV station. And I happened to have the tape rolling and the VCR tape, and I actually got that broadcast, and it's up on my YouTube site. It's called Frozen Hill, and you can see it yourself. That all of a sudden, just everything started crashing. They said it was almost like their TV station got hit by an EMP pulse, and it took down their whole computer system. And the minute they went to the next story, everything started working again. Well, you can imagine, here's me sitting on my couch with my face wired together watching this news broadcast get taken down, and I was really frightened for my life. I was expecting a knock on the door from the men in black, you know. The next day, it had shaken me up so much that I, at that time, David was, I had just watched The Case for NASA UFOs and was just blown away by it. So I thought, you know what? I'm going to get all my UFO footage together, and I'm going to send it to, you know, this guy that I started to really respect, which was David. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know, but right at that time, he was working on the UFOs Unplugged with Dan Aykroyd.
Right, exactly.
And also Pat Uskert.
Yes,
right,
indeed.
Pat was part of the film, yeah.
So we know a lot about David from the business side. That's why I'm asking.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just wondering
that's
if...
what happened is he flipped out when he seen my footage and ended up using about four of those clips in the Dan Aykroyd DVD.
Right.
That led to me and David becoming friends, and at that time is when I had an investor approach me about doing my own DVD of my own story, and David, you know, said, you know, I think you got a really great idea here, and he said, I got a lot of people coming to the table, like Boyd Bushman and, you know, John Hutchinson, and just a lot of people wanted to come forward and be part of this, and he said, let's blow it out into a bigger project, and that became the From Here to Andromeda.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how David got involved.
Okay,
so you had this conversation with this person explaining the Anunnaki and your position, your membership in that group. So what evolved from that or devolved from
that? Well, he told me I was one of two brothers that had incarnated here to try to help during these end times. I had no idea what that even meant. But I just pretty much spent the time with them with that. After that, I started being contacted by a lot of cosmic beings, actually. One gentleman, this is in the flesh. I'm not talking channeling or... I know some of this stuff sounds crazy, and I know a lot of people...
I've got some follow-up
questions.
I've
been so, like, people are like, oh, you're just making all this stuff up. I'm like, I didn't make up a Harvard doctor tell me I don't have normal human blood. You know what I mean? This is just what's happening to me, and I'm just trying to relate, you know, what it is. Since then, there's been a gentleman who was a Mayan elder who showed up, and he said, Michael, I only take this form so you and I can talk and you can understand it. And he proved to me that he could communicate multidimensionally with me. For instance, like, say he would say one thing to me on Monday. Tuesday, I would be out and talking to a totally random person that is not connected at all, and they would mirror back exactly what he told me the day before. And then on Wednesday, I'd see the guy again. He goes, hey, did you get my message yesterday from that lady at the store? Yeah. And I would ask him, how do you do that? You know, how is that even possible? And he talked about astral realms and being able to work in, you know, higher realms to make things happen here. I don't understand it. But the strangest thing out of all this is this Dan Reed fellow that, like I said, he's one of the most gifted musicians that this world's ever known, really. You know, like I said, being picked by Mick Jagger, and he was Bill Graham, legendary show promoter, and he brought Led Zeppelin here, Jimi Hendrix. He managed.
Just to add to the story, did you ever read the Peter Moon stuff, Music in the Key of Time, I think it's called? Peter Moon and Peter Moon is the publisher. And
I've heard of that.
Something in the Key of Music in the Key of Time by the guy who invented the Wall of Sound and Chubby Checker and stuff like that. That guy had a lot to do with the Montauk Boys or something. Does that's That's way before your time, but you might.
No, it does ring a bell, though. I've been, that's a book that I need to check out because it's very. There's a lot of information about this. Like, there's Michael Luckman wrote Alien Rock with
Right. Well, this was Michael Luckman and his friends with Peter Moon, and Peter Moon is not his real name, by the way. We're going to get him on the show soon. He's a publisher, and I'm trying to think of the name of the guy who is the author of Music in the Key of Time. I think it's called. And it'll come to me anyway.
Let me tell you what happened with this. This is really mind blowing because you can start to see how things have unfolded in my life. This guy was a huge inspiration, Dan Reed. I'm talking about on me being a musician. And what had happened was he said he had his own ideas of like when you became as successful as the Rolling Stones, all your problems went away. He said when he toured with them, he said those guys had more drama and BS in their lives than anything he had ever seen. It kind of blew his illusion, you know, that was the path to peace and harmony. Simultaneously, he got a gig to go interview the Dalai Lama for Spin magazine. And he said when he met the Dalai Lama, he met love. Like, here's a guy that lost his whole country and people around him. And yet he radiates nothing but love. And he's like, wow, here's a guy I could really learn something from. So he took all that money that he had made and dropped off the face of the planet and moved into a Tibetan monastery and lived with them for a while and learned from them. I got to share the story because it's funny. He said the only real responsibilities you had is every morning you'd go to the river and you'd wash your clothes and the monks would practice their Tibetan throat singing. He said this one monk came up to him and goes, Dan, I want you to teach me this Western song I heard on the radio. He's like, okay, what is it? He goes, it goes, boom, boom, ch, boom, boom, ch, boom, boom, ch. Dan's like, we will rock you? yes, that's it. So he said he's in, like teaching these monks how to sing We Will Rock You by Queen, you know?
Well, Queen, many people feel Queen was inspired, divinely inspired.
Well, I think the apostles of this time are musicians, you know.
But well, that's the thing. See, that's why this Montauk Boys thing, supposedly, as I remember the book, this particular book, it talks about how the powers that be, the Anunnaki, whoever, the bad guys, realize that music makes vibrations and we can control our population by putting out certain kinds of sounds. And, you know, if it's wall of sound, you know, then that took a generation away, you know, but I think in a good way. So I have a feeling if you think music, just like remote viewing, if you think music's going to be the way to control people, it will rebound on you. And I think music frees people.
Absolutely. Yeah. By the way, A.R. Borden was the head of the remote viewers, the military. I mean, that he was the head of that. And what he told me is they have technology-assisted remote viewing that's called ENS, which is extended neural sensing, I think is...
That's the Montauk chair. That's exactly what we're talking about. See, in other words, the reason they employed sound people, this guy was a sound technician. The reason they employed people like that is because they could make the waves go the way they wanted, I guess. Actually, we should get these people on the show because this might be fun. But anyway,
I can talk to Michael Luckman if you guys don't.
I know Michael.
Well, Michael's just
Michael's great.
He's kind of an angry man. If you sneeze by mistake or something in his presence, something will set him off, and he'll be mad at you for a long time. And then
I've not seen that side of him. I've not spent that much time with him, but I know he had some serious health issues recently where. You know, he said it, you know, not to be funny, this is his own words, he said he had a fall and can't get up episode, and he fell, and he was actually, like, on the ground for 5 days, almost died.
Wow.
He's gotten his health back. Music is so important, you know, and so Dan Reed,
maybe he was in pain when he was snapping people's heads off.
So what did Dan Reed say to you?
Well, in the 90s, he just disappeared off the face of the planet. And to me, it was like Sting never made an album again. And you never knew why. I was like, what happened to Dan Reed? I loved his music, you know? So now in 2009, he resurfaced out of his religious studies and spiritual studies, really, and started touring. And he was the closest place he came to me was Pittsburgh. And so a friend of mine that knew I was a big fan of his got me tickets and got a hotel room there. And me and her made a trip to Pittsburgh, which is about a three-hour drive from where I live,
right,
to see him. And after the show, he came out and met everyone there. And I said, man, I just want to tell you, I'm fascinated by your music and just wanted to thank you. And he said, oh, great. You know, I bought him a drink. So we're talking. He said, Michael, do you know of anywhere that I could get a room tonight? Because, you know, I've not booked a place to stay yet. And I said, well, it just so happens we have a spare bed. You know, there's two beds in our hotel. Come on down. So that's what ended up happening. We ended up playing music all night. And so about 3 o'clock in the morning, we decided to take a walk. We had found an all-night diner that was a Cambodian food place. Mm-hmm. And we were hungry. So me, this friend, the female friend that I had with me, and him were walking down the streets of Pittsburgh, and she can attest to this. She was right behind us. She heard the whole thing. Out of nowhere, Dan says, Michael, you have the bloodline. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, I know something about it, but I'm not really sure what it is, because this was in 2009, and I hadn't learned a lot at this mm-hmm. point. He said, I know, but you will. And he said, it's royal blood. And I said, well, I really don't know what that means. He said, I know, but you will. At this time, we got to the place. I said, well, Dan, how did you know about this blood issue? Did you see the History Channel show? And he said, no. And at this point, I'm thinking, well, how do you know that, you know? And I said, oh, well, that's exactly what I said. Well, how do you know? He said, Michael, it's not coincidence that we're speaking right now. I'm incarnated to find the ancients as they awaken and form a council of the Council of 150. And he said, you're number 63. He said, I have no idea how many of the bloodline is incarnated, but it's first come, first serve for a seat in the council. And I also know who number 64 and 65 is. I probably can't get into that right now, but you can imagine. When different, absolutely not related events correlate, it's like cosmic wink. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, it's sort of the playing Eric Clapton before you came on. I'm telling you, I have one song on my whole millions of songs, and I keep hitting remote or whatever the thing is, next song on the random before the show, and then we'll play some songs and Bill sings. And Layla came on, and I thought, this is just so sweet. We'll just listen to this.
Right on.
So after...
And so I think to myself, everything you're saying, I'm going to listen a little closer.
I know what it sounds like, and, you know, I don't even know what it means. I said, well, Dan, what happens when you get the 150? He was saying that all the members that he's met so far have been musicians, which makes sense from him being a musician. He said he's waiting for the quantum physicists to awaken mm-hmm. and, you know, for the rest of these. But I said, well, what's going to happen when we get to 150? He said, we're going to have a meeting. All right, great, you know. I was expecting a little bit more of an explanation, but that's what it was. But
well, maybe you'll be instant message.
Well,
buddies.
Look, here are the questions. So as you're encountering these individuals, let's just say the ones in the genie bottle, mm-hmm. the like
some folks in chat were not happy with, at that point, because there's no proof to the story.
Well, no, the question that I was asking was this, or what I was going to ask was this: when you encountered these people, what told you that they were telling the truth to you? How did you ascertain truth in what they were saying?
I didn't, to be honest with you. First of all, like I said, it was very antagonistic, and I was very much on my guard and very much trying to center myself and meditate. It wasn't until they said, well, we would like to talk to you. What they told me was when this meeting took place, they said that there would be another planet, heavenly body, visible in our skies very soon. And it wouldn't be a question of, you know, people are going to look at it and go, well, wait a minute, if there's this other planet in the sky, isn't this exactly what this Zachariah Sitchin was talking about?
Exactly.
You know? Go ahead.
No, I'm saying that would be the planet Nibiru. That's
oh, absolutely,
Zachariah
yeah.
Sitchin was talking
so,
about.
So what they said was they wanted to discuss, each one of us, just talk about what we felt would be the implications on human society's, you know, religious programs, you know, economic, governmental, how would people react? And the end of that was everyone in agreement that that mankind should be treated as equals now. And they said that they've had a very hands-on role in helping guide us into higher realms, both negative and positive. That's why you get into this strange thing where some people view the Anunnaki as totally negative, and other people start to understand there's been another...
I was going to suggest in the time-honored Twilight Zone way of, you know, to serve mankind, I wanted to suggest the opposite side. And it could be that, you know, that these are not, you know, these are not friends to mankind.
Well, check this out. If truly, even in the Sumerian telling of this, what happened was the king of this world was named Anu, A-N-U, and his firstborn son was not a pureblood Anunnaki. He was a hybrid himself, where this Anu mated with another female from a whole nother cosmic race. So for the first time in the Anunnaki history, you had new blood coming in on the side of Enki, was his name. Now, Enki was raised to be prince, you know, and take the throne when the time came. But what happened was Anu then had another child with an Anunnaki mother, and that child's name was Enlil. And Enlil was Enki's younger brother. Well, because of Anunnaki succession of kingship rules, that a pureblood will gain over not, you know. So the throne went to Enlil. Make a long story short, it's been, they say that Enlil became known as like the Yahweh of the Bible, that, you know, the vengeful, like, didn't look at mankind very positively.
Right.
Where his brother, Enki, was instrumental in the actual creation of mankind in the Sumerian telling of it. He's the one, him and his sister, did the actual work to create. So they viewed us as mankind. Now, what's said in this is that the Anunnaki, before the last deluge, flood, we lived in peace and harmony. It was truly Eden. There was no starvation. There was no homeless. You know, we were actually like pampered pets and very well taken care of. But the Anunnaki, seeing in the future, their scientists said, oh my God, the crust is going to move. You know, we're going to have we call it a pole shift now, but in their own analogy of this, they're like, well, we don't know what to do. You know, there's 400 million of these humans here now, and it must be God's will. Mm-hmm. Well, Enki wasn't cool with his own peoples not trying to help us. And what is said is, and this is kind of unheard of in their own mythology, because they have a very highly evolved, almost like mass consciousness, like hive mentality. So it'd be kind of like a worker bee going against the rest of them, going, no, I'm not doing that, you know. Well, Enki stood up against them and went to his mother's side and said, hey, isn't there anything that can be done to save this race, because they have so much potential and so much beauty, and my race is just going to let them perish and not even lift a finger to try to help them, because they just say, well, it's God's will. And it's interesting, because this all became known as Noah's, flood myth in the Bible. And
it's also
I don't know if you guys know this.
It's the Democrats and Republicans.
Indeed.
And when it comes down to today, there's still this huge struggle in types. When Cheney, for example, right now, former Vice President Cheney is kind of reemerging every once in a while and doing some talk shows and stuff, and I just find him so scary as just an individual to listen to. So I think to myself, it's almost
energy,
as if,
you know,
they're two races.
You just know they're not going to be a good hang, you know? I like to separate people as they're either a good hang or they're not. You'd either enjoy your time with them or you wouldn't.
Or here's another way of putting it. Perhaps it's not alien, but I often think to myself that you can be the angel in people's lives or the devil, and it's your choice.
Absolutely.
And it's a cool concept.
Well, this all fits into what happened here because from the story, Inky goes to his mother's side and says, isn't there anything that can be done? And they said, well, even if we do save this race, would they evolve to the point that's necessary to be ready for this dimensional shift that's happening at the end of this cycle on December 21st, 2012, which at this time is thousands of years in the future? And by all accounts, the answer was no. Because we were so well pampered and just living in Eden, there wasn't a catalyst for change, for us to evolve faster. So with Inky's mother's side and Inky, a plan was devised to implement an experiment to accelerate human conscious evolution, which meant accelerating both the dark and light energy back, mirroring that back to mankind to in an accelerated fashion. And they divided into two camps. And Graham Hancock had a great way of explaining this. He showed this mural he found, and it was called The Myth of the Churning Ocean. And in this myth, what the most important part was this ocean in their own minds, because in this ocean is what our whole universe rested on in this symbology. And that there was two teams of churners of this ocean, and one team of light and one team of darkness. And Graham Hancock said that what's spiritually encoded in this is that they're working in cooperation to churn the evolution of mankind into the higher realms.
And then you've got the Inky Dinky spider going up the spider spout.
Ah, there you have it. That's a good analogy. You start to see these things are entwined in our mythology through all these, religions and everything.
Well, yeah, in fact, we were talking, I love Graham Hancock, by the way. I just love him. There's a new Graham Hancock piece. I saw it on the internet, so I don't remember why. It's a quick one. It's so brilliant. I think it's TEDx.
Yeah, I love
Graham. So brilliant.
This experiment was put into place. There's one team that reflects back a negative polarity, and truly, if thoughts create reality, no one's asked the question, how do you transmute a negative thought form? Because if thoughts have energy, and energy can't be created or destroyed, it needs to be transmuted into a higher or lower octave. Hopefully, we're going higher. Well, how do you do that? Well, those negative thought forms are brought up in one's own personal reality for you to sink or swim. Either get over it and choose love, and then you transmute it into its higher octave, or you'll keep recreating these same things because you have fear and doubt in your belief system.
We talked about this very thing in the half hour before. You're going to have to re-listen to the show. And the half hour before, we talked a little bit about how much I feel like I have to keep my brain in a positive, functioning way, and I have to surf bad thoughts and surf bad. So I would never watch shows that are going to make me feel down for any reason.
Wise. Absolutely.
Because
be very cognizant of what you allow into your energy field, you know?
Right, because I'm going to create things with my brain. That's my function.
Right. You wouldn't eat bad food.
Right.
So why would you...
If I were an athlete,
I'd
input be really careful.
Bad things?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it's not... And it truly... Here's the weird part. And Michael, this is what you're speaking to, I think. You're not putting your head in the sand. You're not hiding from bad stuff. You're stepping over it almost. You
Absolutely.
Are aware of it the way you're aware a child is bad, but you're going to clean it up. You're going to fix it up. You're going to try to make it better.
Absolutely. And you know, the important part of this is I've seen so many people that just seem to look at this. I call them Anunnaki team bad cop. You know, there's a team good cop. There is this intelligence that's given mankind architecture and agriculture and math, you know, sacred geometry, music,
Terrence McKenna would say that's coming to mankind through the plant teachers, the plant medicines, the ayahuasca brew that tells you, I guess, I hope, how to save the rainforest and stuff. Does that connect in at all with this?
Because DMT is the biggest part of this that people don't understand. For me, this gets into a whole other thing, but from what I understand, when they feel a person is ready, you experience, some people call it the dark night of the soul, because it's sink or swim time. They make, spirit comes in and makes your pineal gland just release DMT 24/7. And which, when people realize, DMT is what makes us dream at night. And so imagine all your dream mythology and symbology manifesting in your waking state. Either you're going to go insane, or you're going to come to grips and you're not going to let your own dark baggage kill you, because it almost killed me until, you know, the end of it, I did choose properly. By the way, this is the fall of 2008 when this episode happened.
Right.
And,
since it's a physical episode, what brings it on? What brought it on, do you think?
I don't know.
Ready for it, or because it was ready for you or something? Or what, you know, did you eat something icky?
What triggered it?
I think it was the timeline of events, you know. The History Channel revealed I didn't have normal blood. Then the Anunnaki met me and said, well, we're going to tell you what that's about. And simultaneously, I was contacted by A.R. Borden and his group of people who are in contact with them and ushered me into, you know, starting to understand this. And then, so you got the History Channel show early 2008. You got meeting the Anunnaki in the middle of 2008, and this ascension process I'm telling you about, the dark night of the soul, happened in the fall of 2008.
And do you know what brought it on?
No, I think it was actually just everything that was happening in my life prior to this, and this was like that's the sink or swim time, you know.
describe what you can remember of it, how its onset.
Well, I'll tell you, I started coming into a lot of very negative information dealing with the extraterrestrial subject through people like James Casbolt and learning about underground bases and all this horrible stuff happening. And truly, my response was, oh my God, I hope this isn't
right.
The truth. And really, what am I doing other than really putting a fear stamp on it? You know what I mean? So when I went through this process, I experienced being hunted down by agents. You know, it was very in my face, but at the same time, I was talking about the DMT being released. I'd walk down to the lake, and as I'm walking down to the lake, there's this huge deer that just walked right past me, like 5 feet away from me, and just acted like I wasn't even there. I'm like, I've never seen a deer down there in my life. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I'm walking a little bit further, and I go around the bend of the beach, and now there's a deer that's dead, and it's halfway up out of the sand. It was the craziest thing. I took some photos of that stuff. It was just crazy. Really weird stuff happening as well as being tracked down by these agents. And I now know what phantasms are. You know, I think that this intelligence that's vetting you, you know, so to speak, it can appear as many different things in our reality.
Well, have you had any of these episodes since?
No. That, I'll tell you how it ended, is through telepathy. I was being told that now that my body is emitting more light, it's very, they have technology. I'm talking about other extraterrestrial races that tell me that could read this. And also, at this time, I had got a puppy, a rescue dog. Actually, I saved her, and she had come into my life. And they're telling me, this voice is like, well, you got to put a blanket over you, because it can act as like an invisibility shield. As long as no part of your body is under, like out of that blanket, they won't be able to see you. And I know this sounds crazy, but so what happened was...
And that's how the Snuggie got invented.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
That's how the Snuggie got invented.
There you have it.
You see?
Okay, so did you put the blanket over you?
I did put the blanket over me, and it got so hot, it was almost like they probably adjusted my body temperature or something, because it became an oven under there, and the dog was to the point, she was sweating so bad, and I was actually blowing on her, like physically with my mouth, you know, trying to cool her off under the blanket, and I was pleading with this intelligence, like, listen, she's going to die, she's panting so bad. And this voice says, well, don't worry about it. You can get another dog. And all of a sudden, I was like, I don't care who you are or who you say you are. I will not follow that, because that, I don't even care. And I threw the blanket off of me. Mm-hmm. And you got to know, during this time, the radio and music became very interactive in my life. It was like, the only way I can explain it is, say you're walking up your driveway and you twisted your ankle and fell down, and then you walked into the house and a song comes on that you heard a million times before, but you never realized that there's this sentence that goes, you know, hey, I just walked up the driveway and twisted my ankle, you know. Everything was becoming very interactive. And right when I threw the blanket off on the radio, just my imagination running away with me came on the radio, and I got it. I was like, thank you. And the most beautiful breeze hit us both. And mm-hmm. I think, I don't know if you guys have ever seen the movie Pan's Labyrinth.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I thought I was going to watch a lighthearted movie. I did stop. I saw the underground. I didn't stay at the very end. So, but I still saw the
best. The very end is the beautiful thing of it, because Pan goes up to her and she has the baby, and Pan's like, listen, all we got to do is take a little pinprick of blood from the baby, and everything's cool. You'll, you'll enter and gain the kingdom, and she won't do it. And then it's weird in the movie, because she's actually then shot by the bad guy.
Right. And I think that's when I stop.
You know, when she wakes up, she is in the kingdom, and Pan comes up to you and goes, I'm so glad you chose properly. I think sometimes some of these higher dimensional people that come to vet you are the ones that bring what you have. It's hard to say. It's almost like in the Matrix movie when the what they call her, the Oracle, says mm-hmm. to Neo, you know, you're going to have your life in one hand and you're going to have someone else's life. And if you choose your own, you've not chosen properly, and you're not going to make it through it, you know. But that's how I kind of, I think it was a test to see if I would choose what you consider just because I was being promised the kingdom, if I would, I would never sacrifice an innocent animal's life, you know, like that, for my own, any kind of gain. And that's when all the testing stopped.
Today, as I was getting ready for the show, we're on the East Coast, and we had a huge bout of warm weather today, 54 degrees. And I was passing on the way down the stairs to go get coffee, a stink bug. We hate stink bugs here. And so I knew I had a choice of either, I was in halfway in the stairs, I could have taken it and put it in the toilet, or taken it outside. And I chose outside. Because I said to myself, my life is not more important than its life.
Right on. I do the same. I a lot of people think I'm crazy because they'll see me carry out a spider, you know. I think that's a beautiful
really
thing,
good,
so yeah. Congratulations. A lot of people aren't that thoughtful, and I think you can tell a level of a person's character by how they treat animals.
Right.
Actually.
Well, it's a slippery slope. Supposedly, there's a cult of people called the Jain, J-A-I-N, that don't even believe in killing flies and stuff, and you have to draw the line if you're a housewife mm-hmm. or a Westerner at some point. I'm just, I throw this in. But the stink bugs really, here's the weird, I'll throw this out into the universe because it's weird. Not, it's a tick of mine. I really do believe that the insects and I communicate, and we'll just leave it at that. They stay on their side as a favor to me.
Oh, right on.
Well, you know, I guess my question to you is, when you were dealing with these people.
Oh, I thought you were going to ask me.
No. When you were dealing with these people in the genie bottle, at some point, you came to believe what they were saying, right? Because obviously, it sounds phantasmagorical, right?
Actually, not really, Bill, because I didn't know what they're even saying. You know, what was interesting is Loki gave me a lot of information dealing with their culture and things like he said that they perceive time differently than we do, because we don't understand that how you perceive time is wrapped up into a planet's orbit. And they live very, very long lives. And he said the only way that we could understand, because we're in it, that said that imagine if we were doing this experiment where we're trying to raise the awareness of an animal like a chimpanzee that was on the threshold of self-awareness, and that we had to go on vacation for 2 weeks. And to them, you know, like 2 weeks right. to them is probably thousands of years. But he said they left for 2 weeks, and when you get back, your chimpanzees have created music and culture and football and religion and government. And he said even from their own perspective and higher just cosmic levels, we're gaining a lot of interest from higher levels because of how fast mankind is truly evolving. And we just don't understand it because we're part of it. But, you know, in the 1950s, we wouldn't allow a black person to drink out of the same water fountain or, you know,
when
and we Betty didn't even
Hill,
look.
When Betty Hill and Barney Hill had their UFO experience, had their abduction experience in 1961, Betty Hill and Barney Hill, Betty was white, Barney was African-American. When they had their experience, a marriage between a white person and an African-American was illegal in something like 10 states, 1961. It took a Supreme Court decision to
states, they weren't publicity hounds.
The 14th Amendment guarantees the right to marriage interracially. So, but I mean, that was literally, when you say 1950s and 1960s, that was America then. And
yeah,
we evolved politically from there.
But well, if we renamed Congress the zoo, this is where the less evolved monkeys ended up,
mm-hmm.
and just kind of blocked it off and called it the zoo instead of Congress, and we went on with our business state by state or whatever, it would solve a lot of problems.
Okay, so Michael, so here you are. So here you are in the tent, and did you get an explanation for why all this could be going on, and where's the government? Where's the military? Where are the world's militaries?
Yes, because this is what's crazy, is because they live so long of lives that their kingship list, and by the way, they told me that their own kingship, this is what, like, I couldn't make this stuff up. I hadn't read a Zachariah Sitchin book. Mm-hmm. They told me that their whole governmental succession of leadership is based on the processional cycle. At that time, I didn't know even what the processional cycle was, mm-hmm. but they said that this experiment in duality to accelerate human consciousness would end at the end of the age of Pisces, and that the marking of the age of Aquarius would mark a new way that the Anunnaki relate to mankind, and it would usher in a new time of how mankind is, like, pretty much. He told me that, imagine that you got a chessboard and there's 20 players on each side of the chessboard, and that the chessboard, the players, these 20 players are multidimensional in the fact that some are was born in the 1800s, some even, you know what I mean? It's throughout time. And
right.
at the end of this, whoever had enough players left on the board to make a difference at the end would earn the right to help mankind in how they seem fit. And truly, from what I understand, it comes down to some of them really feel that mankind needs guidance and that left alone, we won't do well. And whereas other camp thinks that we've earned the right now to be treated as equals. But because of these long lives that they lead, Marduk was slated, this is way into the future, that at this time he would gain the kingship throne of the Earth realm, because they had two kingship thrones, one over the Earth realm and one in Nibiru. And unbeknownst to him, in the future, that this experiment in duality would be implemented to try to help us, actually, Marduk took over reflecting a negative polarity, and you find out all these secret societies and the Skull and Bones and, you know, all these people, they're catering to Marduk, who is, his spiritual purpose is to reflect back a negative polarity. So,
does that have anything to do with Lucifer and the whole thing about don't go to the light and the moon is sucking your soul up?
I don't know. You know, the whole thing, I was agnostic before all this happened, so a lot of labels, they don't mean as much to me as they do other people, but, you know, Inki of the Anunnaki, who was took mankind's side, has been known as many different names through many different cultures. Like in Tibet, the name Mietra means loving kindness, and in Sumeria, when Inki was depicted, he always had water erupting from his shoulders, or he was holding buckets of water, and the water represented, they call it the water of life, which was like divinity, true spiritual truth. And in the Mietra, in the Tibetan culture, is always depicted with water erupting out of his shoulders, you know?
And also it could usher in Aquarius.
Exactly. Aquarius is a man holding buckets of water. It is Inki. And this
right.
is said to be Inki's time. And that's what they told me, which, again, I couldn't make that stuff up, you know? But, so, Inki, though, is really fascinating because, as I said, he went against his own kind and went to his mother's race and said, we need to help this race. And that's why the Nephilim was created, because from Inki's mother's side, they said, you can't do anything to an upcoming consciousness that you're not willing to go through yourself, especially something that's never been tried before. So the Nephilim bloodline was created so the Anunnaki could actually, they had to, under this treaty that was being created, incarnate as humans and walk a mile in our moccasins, so to speak. And, you know, when you're born into this realm, you take on the mass consciousness's belief system upon birth through your DNA, all the hopes.
And the Nephilim intermarried with the humans, right? And you then had a third race of a hybridized creature that came to be. Until Noah.
Well, actually, from what I understand, the Nephilim actually is the hybrid race of the Anunnaki human hybrid bloodline, is the Nephilim. And let me tell you, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Bloodline.
Yes.
So Nicholas Haywood, who is the spokesman for the Priory of Sion, by the way, the Knights Templar have contacted me now, and I've been talking with Nicholas Haywood, and I asked him, I said, is this bloodline you're talking about between Mary Magdalene and Jesus, and they had children, and this line of children, I said, is this the Nephilim bloodline? I mean, it sounds like it, and he said, yes. And I said, is the Nephilim bloodline, does it connect back then to the Anunnaki? And he said, absolutely. And that's what's going to be revealed here soon. And by the way, A.R. Borden told me this whole bloodline issue is going to be entering the scientific journals within the next 5 years.
And in what way? How?
You mean your blood?
No,
yeah.
But how? How? Entering journals, how? Saying
I don't know. Actually, that came out yesterday in the interview. He said, just so you know, this because we talked about the bloodline issue a little bit, and that's what came out of them.
Well, let's speculate for a second. Maybe they would say they did some DNA tests on the bones they just dug up of, they think, Henry VIII or whoever it was.
Richard III.
And maybe they're going to then say, well, there's this weird thing about his blood that they now know, and so forth and
Absolutely.
So on.
Absolutely. Well,
bloodline.
Right before Zachariah Sitchin's death, he put out a, he said, to all these people, well, I think it was Nefertiti or some mummy that we have still, like the remains are here. He said, do a DNA testing on it and reveal what it is. We'll put an end to this right here quick, you know. But according to the Bloodline movie.
Then you talked to Freeman. Have you ever heard of Freeman Fly? Freeman, well, he calls himself Freeman. That's not his real name, but that's how he goes on the web and everything. And he's got this whole thing. He's got a radio show. He's a really great guy. And he's got this concept of Obama is the reincarnation of one of them.
ISIS?
No, with the longer head.
Oh.
The really weird one. The one that was almost Christ-like.
Akhenaten.
Yeah.
Akhenaten.
And then Michelle is a dead ringer. And in fact, did you ever see the thing on it's music. It ties everything up. It brings the whole room together here. They found a statue in a museum that looks exactly like Michael Jackson, and it's been in the museum forever, long before Michael Jackson, and long after. When you see it,
yeah,
is Michael Jackson.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. And so that's and my many people feel he's a total alien. So anyways,
well, you know, my thought, Michael, and we only have like 60 seconds left. Yeah, but my thought is always
next week we have Ruben. Ruben.
Yeah, Ruben Uriarte is going to be here next week from MUFON, California. The my thought has always been that time. That people are moving back and forth through time. And so seeing Michael Jackson in a museum is you're seeing someone who came back from the future and had a whole life before he became Michael Jackson.
Okay, so anyway, that being said, stay tuned for Fringe Radio with guest Trish Lesage and Elizabeth Joyce.
And to Michael Lee Hill, thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much. It's been a joy talking to both of you.
It went so fast.
I want to talk to you. We'll talk an email about Borden, and we'll talk an email about Haywood.
Right on. I got to tell you, I've been contacted by Bigelow Aerospace as well, and I got a lot of info to share with you about what I've learned from them.
That's another whole show.
We will share with everybody, okay?
Wow. Right on.
Hi, Michael, and we will talk very, very soon. And to everybody in our listening audience, we are your co-hosts, Bill, that's me, and Nancy.
Good night.
Burns, good night from Primrose Creek on Daylight Savings Time night, and spring is springing up through the grass. See you next week with Ruben Uriarte as our guest. Good night from
Primrose
Creek.
Okay, thanks.
Kiss me.